very much. Thank you, Dave, for that introduction. It reminds me of the story of the lieutenant governor who was serving during the time when South Dakota still hung horse thieves. And the word was in this small town that a man was going to be hung for horse thievery. And the lieutenant governor thought, well, there'll be a lot of people present. I better be there. And as is customary, they led the condemned man to the scaffold. And they asked him if he had any last words. He thought a minute and said no. And the lieutenant governor stepped forward and said, well, do you mind if I say a few words then? And the condemned man said, please hang me first, hang me first. It is good to be here, good to be back in Mitchell. It's good to have the rain. I could come in from the rain and someone could say, Governor, you're all wet, and I could still pretend that they meant that it was because I was wet. But it was good to be here. I'd like to begin this day of workforce study with three stories. The first story starts a few months ago, last September, when I was here in Mitchell. I was meeting with some business leaders right here in this room. Some of them are here today. I was meeting with the business leaders, and that September afternoon, they wanted to talk about workforce. I was in town for another reason, and they said, you know, can we get a minute to talk to the governor while he's in town? And we're in a building, and we went downstairs to have a few minutes to visit, and they talked about their concerns about workforce. They told me they couldn't expand their businesses without workers. They told me because of workforce shortages, they'd been turning down business. They told me that workforce was the single largest threat to economic development in South Dakota, in their estimation. What was interesting about that conversation was that I'd heard something very similar earlier that week in Sioux Falls. I'd been with some Chamber of Commerce directors and the Development Foundation directors and asked them the question, if you could think of one thing that the state could do to help your community with economic development, what would it be? And they broke into small groups and came back, and a few of the groups had some different ideas, but most of the groups identified workforce. So in the course of 1 week, I heard it in two of our most vibrant communities. And I'm here today in large part because of those meetings. Of course, I've been working on workforce just as many of you have. And as Dave mentioned, we were here together a couple of years ago talking about workforce. My first year in office, I made economic development a priority. You might remember, of course, we were still emerging from the recession at that time. South Dakota, as you look at job growth, we didn't have growth during the recession. We had job losses for a period of time, and we bottomed out in 2010, about mid-year, and then started to slowly climb back our job numbers. But during that first year in office in early 2011, I went to dozens and dozens of businesses to try and learn what I could from you, the business community, and said, what does state government need to do or stop doing so your business can grow? And the answer, even then, even in early 2011, when we were still emerging from the bottom of the recession, was workforce. That was the answer. So back then, we responded with South Dakota WINS. That's this logo here on the right, SD WINS, our South Dakota Workforce Initiative. And we had 20 different programs to try and address what we thought might be some of the shortfalls in our workforce strategies. And we've had some successes, some of them great successes, and you'll hear about some of those from a panel in just a moment. But that meeting here in Mitchell last September reminded me that this work is never done. Just as Dave Owen reminded us, our efforts to address workforce challenges need to be persistent and ongoing and ever adapting to changing conditions. There's always more we can do. Now, every state faces this problem. In fact, it's interesting, I'm a member of the National Governors Association, and our current president is the governor of Oklahoma, Mary Fallon. And each incoming governor of the National Governors Association has their initiative. What's her initiative? Workforce. Workforce. So we're seeing this across the country. Simply put, we have a shortage of workers whose skills are aligned to the jobs that are available. And in South Dakota, that problem is exacerbated because our economy is pretty good in comparison to other places. You know, during the recession, the nation lost jobs. And some of you have heard me talk about this before. In South Dakota, we lost about 8,000 jobs. We started in early 2009, January, I think it was, of 2009. And you compare January of 2009 to January of 2008, and we had fewer jobs in January. In February, fewer still. March, fewer still. Month after month after month, all the way through the middle of 2010, we went down month after month after month. We lost 8,000 jobs. But today, we're among about 15 states that have recovered all those jobs, and we've added still more. So we're well beyond our pre-recession height. We have more jobs now than ever before in our history as a state. Some jobs some states are still below their pre-recession heights. In fact, the nation as a whole remains below its pre-recession heights. South Dakota, we're well above it. And we've been growing faster than the United States here in South Dakota. In fact, since 2008, our GDP growth has exceeded the nation's by over 4%. We have productive, strong businesses that have been growing and want to continue to grow. And for years, we've told the world that South Dakota is open for business. Bring your business to South Dakota. Or if you're already here, expand your business here in South Dakota. We've been pitching that hard. We've been pitching job creation. And if that's going to continue to be true, we need to address the workforce issue. So the moral of the first story is workforce efforts have to be an ongoing, persistent effort. It's a marathon. It's not a sprint. Moral of the story, continue to work on workforce. My second story starts with a conversation I had with Paul and Terry. There's Paul over there. Terry's around here somewhere. Muth Electric here in Mitchell. They told me their top 30 electricians make over $91,000. Can you imagine that? That's a little more than double what your typical college graduate makes. And yet, people see the skilled trades as not a place to go for job opportunity. We know that we have a national skills gap, not just in South Dakota, but nationally. The current people looking for jobs don't have the skills to perform the jobs that are available. Even those states that have high unemployment, where there are many people looking for work, there are many jobs available. South Dakota is the same way. In 2011, when the United States unemployment rate exceeded 9%, a McKinsey survey of businesses documented that 30% of U.S. companies had jobs open for more than 6 months that they couldn't fill, even though our unemployment rate was 9%. And that skills gap exists because people don't fully appreciate the value of quality skilled jobs. The skills gap exists because people aren't aware of things like the salary that Terry and Paul were telling me about. In this state and in this country, we pay people for skilled work. Fewer and fewer and fewer jobs are available to the high school graduate alone. You have to have some post-secondary training. And for whatever reason, that message has not yet resonated. Or if it has, the high school graduates of today don't understand where the paths are that lead to jobs. They have lots of dreams, and they know there are lots of paths available, but they don't know which ones lead to jobs and which ones lead to a degree for which there is no demand. And we need to send that message. Now, I know your community here in Mitchell is aware of this skills gap and is trying to do what it can to provide technical training. Obviously, the facility we're in right here, Mitchell Tech, is a leading example of the high quality programs that are available and that have the ability to narrow this skills gap between jobs available and people who have the skills to fill those and match up. In my conversations with many of you, we've talked about the importance of informing our young people about the opportunities available in skilled careers. I can't tell you how many times I've been discouraged by young people who talk about their aspirations for post-secondary education, and they have decided to enter into a field for which I know there are very few jobs available. I know they're going to take on a lot of debt, and they're going to graduate with a degree that doesn't get them a better job than they could have had right out of high school, because that degree has no demand for jobs. In Germany, most students finish high school between the ages of 15 and 18, somewhere in there, depending upon what type of school they attend. At that point, the student has the choice to go on to university study or into what's called the vocational training program. And this latter part is a dual program that combines classroom studies with work experiences to train students for specific jobs following their high school graduation. Over 350 occupations are available through this second track, this vocational track. And the program typically takes between 2 to 3.5 years to complete. In most instances, the work experiences are direct apprenticeship programs for private companies that may offer students employment after graduation. The majority of German students choose this track. Between 60 and 70% of them choose that track, depending on the year. The United States, I believe, needs to continue to improve the connection between business and education, and we need to give our young people a clear vision of their career opportunities, not just the paths that are available, but whether those paths truly lead to opportunity or whether they lead to a degree for which there is no demand. In South Dakota, we do a fairly good job, but we need to improve. We definitely need to improve. Now, there's one more troubling condition. Even if we're absolutely successful in providing job seekers and future job seekers clear and realistic information about occupational demands in South Dakota, and even if we achieve perfect alignment between students who look for jobs, find career paths that lead to them, and then find those jobs at the end of the path, we're still going to have workforce challenges. In a very unscientific, simple math calculation, one can look at the number of job openings we had last week. Last week, about 14,500 job openings on our posting system. Also check the number of people that were unemployed looking for work, about 16,900. So pretty fair alignment between the two numbers, pretty fair alignment. And later today, you're gonna hear, I know, from some economists who's going to give a more detailed description of South Dakota's job seeker versus job openings numbers. But you're going to hear, essentially, in many of our industry sectors, it's a one-to-one thing. That statistic doesn't allow for any margin of error, right? You got to have all job seekers perfectly aligned to the job openings and the skill sets needed for those openings. There's really almost no room for error. So if there is no room for error, we have to be almost perfect. And secondly, if we are perfect, it allows no opportunity for growth. That's today's job openings. That's just today. If you want to add more jobs, if you get more contracts, if you want to expand your business, then what? So the moral of this second story is skills training must align. It must align. We don't have any margin for error. So we need to work really hard to get our students to understand where the job openings are going to be so they can prepare themselves or they're going to be unemployed. And that's the third story now. A fellow named Peter was working in the manufacturing industry in Rhode Island, but he wasn't satisfied there. And as you know, we have a real need for technicians in engineering, financial services, manufacturing, IT, and other areas. And we have more need today than we can realistically meet with only the people living here today, especially considering the skills mismatch. So to grow the economy in South Dakota, we need to grow this state's population. We need Peter to move to South Dakota. Luckily, he did. In March, Peter accepted a position as a key operator at Bell Brands, the new food processing cheese plant in Brookings. So he and his wife moved to Brookings, and his children are learning in our schools. Peter and his wife are adding to our economy, and their family is adding to their community. Our efforts to recruit people into South Dakota to fill immediate job openings have been mixed. Dakota Roots has been more successful than we thought it would be. And another program called New South Dakotans has been a little bit less successful than expected. The two programs together, though, have recruited 4,300 people into our state in the last couple of years. That's more than the cities of Baltic, Big Stone City, Bridgewater, Bison, Burke, and Britton combined. So that's a lot of people for a small state like South Dakota. The programs have added as many people to our state as live in Tea or Hot Springs. Now, we know that bringing more workers to South Dakota is part of the answer, and we know that we don't have enough new workers here yet. So in order to get more people here, we need to do a good job of telling our story about South Dakota. South Dakota has a lot to be proud of. And I know our citizens are humble by nature, but we need to make sure we aren't shy about telling the good story of South Dakota, that we're one of the best places in the nation to live. I had a chance to talk to the top 1% of our high school graduating class yesterday. Every school district chooses their top 1%. So if you've got 100 seniors, it's the top single person. If you've got 200 seniors, it's the top two, 1%. Hundreds of students came to Pierre yesterday and I talked to them. And one of the stories I told them was, don't be misled by the bright lights of the big city, because you'll soon find that those so-called higher salaries also are accompanied by much higher taxes and much higher costs and a much less satisfying quality of life. And after a period of time, those bright lights are a little bit annoyingly bright and glaring, and it's not so fun to sitting gridlock on your way to work. And so I tried to tell them to think about South Dakota, and I used statistics about how our cost of living is among the lowest in the nation, by some measures, the lowest cost of living in the nation, and that our taxes are very minimal, and our per capita income is above average. And when you account for all those things, we're one of the best places to live in America, measured by numbers alone, economy alone. Then you add to that the quality of life things I mentioned, great health care, great education, low commute time, beautiful environment. It's a great place to live, and we need to sell it. We regularly find our name on the top of objective, independent national rankings. CNBC named us America's top state for business. Barron's best run states in the nation. We were number 2 and number 3 in recent years. Tax Foundation named us third lowest in total tax burden, total taxes. Forbes named Sioux Falls as the best small place to do business. We also topped the list in a lot of quality of life rankings, 7th in our volunteering rate, 2nd for personal credit. If people loan you money, you pay it back here. 7th for a quality of life ranking, which considered crime rates, health care, education, recreation, environment, all those good things about South Dakota. So we need to tell that story. All of us need to tell that story. I went to Minneapolis last year and spent an afternoon in the Mall of America talking to people about coming to South Dakota. A lot of people ridiculed that, and I knew that would happen. I mean, what's the governor of South Dakota standing around a kiosk for? Well, I knew I wouldn't meet very many people that way, but I also knew I'd be a spectacle, and I'd get television, and I'd get newspaper, and I did. And our hit rate on our Dakota Roots doubled that week. And that's where we got the hit, not by me standing around. I was the attention getter that got the stories. But while I was at the mall, I talked to a guy named Brian, who's done business in South Dakota. However, instead of talking about business, Brian wanted to talk about what a great place South Dakota was. Talk about his visits here, the people he's met, our wonderful recreational opportunities. He just loved South Dakota. It wasn't the business, it wasn't the numbers. It was just a love of our state. It's a great state. And I just got an email from him last week that his wife is looking for a job here because they want to move here. He can work wherever he lives because he's got that kind of a job. And he travels a lot. And he has a job, as I said, allows him to live anywhere. But he wants to be here because he feels welcome. He likes the people. He's excited about our quality of life. And so it's our job to make sure communities all over South Dakota tell that story, because we've got a great story to tell. So the moral of the third story is we need skilled workers to come or return to South Dakota, and we all must be ambassadors. My wife, Linda, God bless her. She is one of the best ambassadors for South Dakota. She carries Dakota Roots cards in her purse. And you know, we'll be someplace in California, or we'll be at a National Governors Association meeting in Washington, and she'll run into someone that has some connection to South Dakota. And I'll just be chatting along thinking, well, now we gotta go to this meeting, and then she'll be pulling a Dakota Roots card out of her purse and say, you need to move back to South Dakota. Here's the card, go to this website, find job opportunities. And she remembers things because, like that, because she knows in our heart of hearts, we don't really care that much about how much money we make or how much stuff we accumulate. We care about the people that are meaningful in our lives, and especially our brothers and sisters and parents and children. And those are the roots that bring people back to South Dakota. And so she seizes every opportunity to help people help themselves find a happier life, closer to the people that love them. So I use those three stories today to make the three points that we're going to be exploring today, among others. One, workforce has to be addressed if our state is going to be open for business. We need to address it. It's the key problem today that confronts economic development. And I don't mean to portray the problem as more than it is, because our economic situation is very good in South Dakota. God bless being governor of a state like South Dakota. I feel sorry for Pat Quinn, the governor of Illinois. His state is a train wreck. South Dakota, it's wonderful to be governor of South Dakota. But even in the midst of that wonderful condition, we can be better, and workforce is the number one way in which we can be better. Secondly, if you look at the number of people looking for work and the number of job openings, it's a one-to-one thing. So there's no room for error given our current population. So we need to be very focused if we're going to address this. And thirdly, we can't depend upon perfection. We need to bring people in to fill some of these spots that we can't meet through imperfection and through the realities of our demographics. So our population is only growing so fast, and our business is growing faster. So we need to get some of those bodies back to South Dakota, where they belong anyway, right? They want to be in their heart of hearts. So today, I hope we'll all discuss how to address these challenges. We've got a great program, and I know you're going to love it. Thank you so much for allowing me here to kick it off.